When we have differences, the enemy gains strength. Success is achieved when everyone has one mind. The best example of this is the Battle of Kharda. This was the last battle fought by all the Maratha chiefs together with one heart and one cause. The Nizam was the strongest enemy of the Marathas in the south. During the reign of Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj of Satara, Peshwa Bajirao and his son Nana Sahib and later Peshwa Madhavrao fought this rival successfully. This continued during the reign of Savai Madhavrao. In today's episode, we take a look at the Battle of Kharda, which took place in 1795. After Peshwa Madhavrao defeated the Nizam's army in the Battle of Rakshasbhuvan, the Nizam was paying his tributes as a quarter share of the revenue from time to time. But after Madhavrao's death, the Nizam stopped paying tributes. The arrears of this amount by now had reached rupees 3 crores. During these years, the Peshwas received the charter of Wakil-e-Mutlak from the Delhi court, which caused a great uproar among the Nizam ranks. Sayyid Ghulam Hussain Irani, commonly known as Mainud-Daula or Mushir-un-Mulk, was the wazir at Nizam's court. He was a cunning man. He proposed that instead of giving a pending share of rupees 3 crores and the province of Bid, which was worth 30 lakhs to the Marathas, we should instead invest the sum to build our strong army and attack the Marathas to finish them for once and all. Around the same time, the death of Mahadji Shinde and Haripant Phadke, two of the most powerful generals in the Maratha forces, led to a military leadership vacuum among the Maratha ranks, or so thought Nizam. Peshwa's lawyer Govindrao Kale was deputed at the court of Nizam in Hyderabad. Always keeping his eyes and ears open, these lawyers also played a role of spies from time to time. At Pune, Narayan Rao's son Savai Madhavrao was the Peshwa at this time, while intellectual Nana Fadnavis was in charge of politics. Nana Fadnavis in Pune was informed about Nizam's plans through a letter by Govindrao Kale. At the beginning of November 1794, Govindrao Kale informed Nana that Nizam's forces are marching from Bidar towards Pune via Ahmednagar. With this news, security of the Pune city was deputed to Madhavrao Kanade, and the Peshwa's troops left Pune, marching east crossing the Ghod River towards Srigonda. The first base of the Peshwa army was set up at Mirasgao on the banks of the river Sina. The troops of Patwardhan, Shinde, Holkar and Bhosles from Nagpur had camped at Ghodegaon near Jamkhed. These camps were sizably large and had the appearance of a large city. These military encampments extended to the nearby villages of Ratnapur and Dhanore. By now, Nizam's army was nearby, stationed at a village named Talsangi on the banks of the river Khar, which was about 2 miles towards the Balaghat range from the village of Kharda. The spies on both sides were at business by now. As the troops approached, the surveillance began. There were some skirmishes around this time, and now both the sides were preparing for the battle. One day, Ramchandra Baba Phadke, a prominent commander in the Maratha army, was patrolling 4 to 5 miles outside the camp. He was suddenly attacked by the Nizam's army of about 5,000 riders. Phadke was riding with only 400 riders. Unsurprisingly, he had to retreat. Some of Phadke's men and horses were seized by the Nizam's men who were out to collect fodder for the animals. Nizam's Diwan, Mushir-un-Mulk, was overjoyed with the news of this initial success. He invited the Maratha courtman Govindrao Kale to visit his master Nizam at a certain time. As soon as Govind Pant arrived, the Diwan ordered the performers of the court to begin a show. These artists at the court were cross-dressed, that is, men were dressed as women. They staged a farcical drama of a battle, in which Nana Fadnavis, Parshuram Bhav Patwardhan, Daulat Rao Sindhia and other Maratha chieftains were badly mocked. This was a planned insult of Govind Rao and of the Marathas in that sense. Govind Rao was hurt and annoyed. Fuming out of the dormitory, he wrote about it to Nana Fadnavis, describing everything that he had witnessed. And then Nana Fadnavis invited all the Maratha chieftains for a meeting in a huge encampment named Dalbadal, which was built at the village of Ratnapur. The attendants filled the court. The court was so large and spacious that it accommodated almost 5,000 people. At this meeting, Courtman Trimbak Rao Parchure read aloud the letter from Govind Rao Kale to the assembly. This insult by the Nizam made everyone furious and craving for revenge. After much consideration, the leadership of the expedition was handed over to Parshuram Bhav Patwardhan. Under Parshuram Bhav Patwardhan and Ramchandra Phadke, Lakoba Nana and Jivadatta Bakshi were deputed by the Shindes. The Bhosles appointed Vitthal Pant Subedar to the vanguard. Holkar forces were planned to be led by Bapurao Holkar under the management of Kashi Rao. The Gaikwad and Vinchurkar troops were to join the Royal Regiment. All these armies camped at Ghodegaon. At this time, the Marathas had an army of about 84,000 cavalry, 38,000 infantry and 182 cannons, while the Nizam had 45,000 cavalry, 44,000 infantry and 108 guns. The Shinde artillery was led by a European gunner named Perron in their ranks, while the Nizam had a Frenchman, Raymond, leading their artillery. Noticing that the Marathas had blocked the crossings of the Khar River, on March 11, 1795, the Nizam's forces marched towards Ghodegaon. The Maratha armies had their formations ready. Parshuram Bhav was on the vanguard with the Royal Regiment and had Shinde's flank on the left, Holkar on his right and his nephew Vitthal Pant Patwardhan on his back. While Parshuram Bhav was looking for a place to set up the artillery, the Nizam army launched a sudden attack, and before anyone could materialize the plan, the battle began. The initial skirmish was fierce. 400 riders from the Patwardhan army fell, while Nizam also lost equally. In the action that ensued, Patwardhan's nephew Vitthal Pant joined the action in the vanguard on his horse. He charged against two Pathan armies that were at the lead, and then managed to slay their leaders. Suddenly he was shot by someone at heart. He fell off his horse and died. Meanwhile, another Pathan troop attacked his cousin, the leader Parshuram Bhav. Parshuram Bhav suffered a cut above his right eye and had to retire. Seeing the Patwardhan vanguard retreating, after their leader was injured, the Nizam army then attacked Daulat Rao Shinde, who was open on the left flank. Noticing this, the Holkar army and the Royal Regiment surrounded the Nizam and launched a fierce attack. At the same time, a formation led by the Vinchurkar army and Nilkanth Rao Ramchandra Prabhu came forward. These two troops now led the charge. Lala Khan Pathan, a prominent commander of the Nizam army, was riding a small elephant shooting arrows. A rider from the Vinchurkar troop courageously stepped forward and killed Lala Khan Pathan. Noticing Lala Khan dead, Wazir Khan Pathan now stepped forward. Nilkanth Rao Prabhu then confronted Wazir Khan and subdued him. Another commander, Ashgul Khan, was also killed in this combat. Shinde artillery then aimed at the Nizam army. Perron was accurate. Nizam was found in a state of shock at his efficiency. The Nizam's army could not stand any longer. Finally, that evening, just before the sunset, the Maratha artillery stopped. Now about 12,000 men from the Holkar's Pindari army raided the Nizam's camp to loot. Feeling that the Marathas were leading a night attack on him, the Nizam's army quickly retreated towards the fort of Kharda, which was nearby. 1,500 Nizam soldiers were killed during this retreat. Nizam had to also leave behind much of his artillery and ammunition, which now fell into the hands of the raiding Maratha armies. The following day, on March 12, 1795, the Maratha armies sieged the fort of Kharda. A strong shelling by the Maratha artillery continued resiliently. Knowing that he would no longer hold against this strong attack, with his limited resources, the Nizam surrendered and requested the lawyers to negotiate. Considering the history with Nizam, everyone was of the opinion that he should not be spared alive. Eminent historian Mr. Sardesai notes that Nana Fadnavis, probably foreseeing the rise of British, spared his life considering a future alliance. In his letter to Satara, Nana Fadnavis writes that the Nizam had earlier helped us in the south, hence his life was spared. However, Nana Fadnavis approved the treaty on the condition that Nizam's Diwan, Mushirun Mulk Mainudola Ghulam Sayyid Irani, who had insulted the Marathas, be surrendered unconditionally. The treaty was signed on these clauses. Mainudwala Ghulam Sayyid Irani to be handed over to the Marathas, a total amount of 5 crores to be paid to the Marathas within 3 years, territory worthy of 3 lakhs of revenue, and the fort of Daulatabad to be surrendered to the Marathas. The territories which Nizam had occupied of the Bhosles of Nagpur should be returned at once. In a document found in the Patwardhan records, there are 2 noteworthy clauses added to this treaty, which seem to shed light on the state of politics and the beliefs of that era. There should be no cow slaughter in the Deccan. Similarly, the Muslim region, the Taziyas, the Khudaparasti, and so on should be practiced unhampered in Maharashtra. The Hindu and the Muslim are both equal children of God. No molestation of Hindu shrines should be offered by the Muslims. The Hindus have shown no disrespect and done no harm to the Muslim shrines, to their peers or their paigambar. In the same way, no molestation should be offered by the Muslims to the Hindu worship. Both should practice their respective creeds freely without interfering with each other. When the Nizam pleaded constantly to his inability to pay 5 crores, Nana Fadnavis agreed at accepting 3 crores and 10 lakh rupees in cash and about 34 lakh rupees in territorial collections. On March 27, the victorious forces of the Marathas left for Pune, reaching on 1st of May 1795. Nana Fadnavis had briefed about this battle and subsequent victory in a letter to Satara. Baburao Apte, the courtier at Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj II in Satara, replied back congratulating Nana on behalf of the king. Nizam Ali, on the other hand, took this defeat to his ego. He is seen unburdening his mind to the British resident Kirkpatrick in September 1795, where he writes, "The Panth Pradhan of Pune is a source of great annoyance to me, and I am constantly anxious to avenge my wrongs upon him. If you are our friend and ally, should you not help me in my time of distress?" To which Kirkpatrick replied, "I cannot answer this proposition without the orders from my masters." This certainly makes us wonder whether sparing his life after the battle was a wise decision. Alas, history cannot be changed. This victory of Kharda has an important place in the history of Marathas. This was a decisive victory of the Marathas over the Nizam after a long period of nearly 30 years. This unfortunately was also the first and last victory of Savai Madhorao's career. 7 months later, Savai Madhorao took a fall at Shaniwarwada and died on 27th of October 1795. Regrettably, the Marathas after this battle also forgot that success is achieved when everyone has one mind, and this ended up as the last great victory of the combined forces of the Maratha Empire. Thank you for watching our video. If you like this video, please do leave a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon. You are watching Historiography.